Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to this parallel session dedicated to the role of small and medium enterprises in on reaching the Sustainable Development Goals on Agenda 2030. We are pleased to welcome a very powerful panel that Mario is going to introduce. Mario, you're the director of the Development Center of the OECD and the special advisor to the Secretary General on development. We'll do two rounds of questions with your panelists, and they'll have each 4 to 5 minutes to answer, after which there will be a time for question and answers and engagement with you all. There'll be roving mics around the room for you to use, until, and then we'll close for lunch. So Mario, without further ado, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Bernard. Thank you for being here with us. Yes, it is a very interesting panel within a general discussion about SDGs, the private sector. When we first started discussing this point in the OECD, some colleagues emphasized the role that OECD entrepreneurs can play in developing countries. But private sector is not a prerogative of OECD countries. In developing countries, private sector is very lively and is composed by different actors, in particular SMEs. That's why we want to discuss this specific aspect, knowing that it is a driver of potential development in these countries. And to do that, we wanted to have a panel that cannot be more perfect than the one that we have. In fact, here we have Carolina Castro, which is Undersecretary of State in Argentina, a country which is engaged in major efforts to address the potential of the economy and therefore drive further development. But together with Carolina Castro, we have also the Islamic Development Bank and Rami, which is a senior advisor to the president and special envoy on SDGs. So we have a bank that is actively engaged in identifying action that can help achieving the SDGs, and we are all in that general effort. But okay, we have a government, we have a major international bank, we cannot lack the private sector, and Tata is with us. Tata, we will hear in a second what is Tata for those that yet don't know the detail, because I'm sure that the name is very well known. And well, what best than a company from developing countries, a large company that works in developing and developed market, and which is just the point of an iceberg which is composed by many other private actors, the small firms that work for and with Tata. Last but not least, we have the director that in OECD is in charge of small and medium-sized firms. Actually, the only director in the OECD that comes from Africa, Lamia Kamal-Chaoui, which is Moroccan of origin and French, and that is here to tell us what we have observed, not only in OECD countries, but also in developing countries. Therefore, the panel could not be better. The issue is complicated. When we say small and medium-sized firms, there are a lot of ambiguities around these issues and what we pretend from small and medium-sized firms. For example, we have small and medium-sized firms that are traditional car repairers in the valley of Colombia, where the condition of life recalls somehow the famous Macondo of Garcia Marquez. Local market where the cars need to be repaired, where you do not have exactly the spare parts that need to repair the car, where the artisan doesn't have a formal training, he or she uses very universal machine to repair the different problems that can appear. Nothing is with strict tolerance, but you have to address all the problems that your customers in your small village have. At the same time, we can have dependent subcontractor in Cordoba that works for large automotive firm. Actually, sometimes they have been workers in these large automotive firms, and then they decided to start up by themselves. Sometimes using the machine that was in use in the factory where they used to work before. These are very well trained workers, now entrepreneurs. They went to school, they know trigonometry, they also learned a lot on the job, sometimes with a spectrum which is anyhow defined by the customer firms. Very often they are dependent subcontractor, and so the relationship with the firms is crucial. And finally, in Ghana, we have an area where there are many small firms producing in the automotive sector, sometimes capable to do little innovation, and little by little summing one innovation to the other, they are even capable to produce real innovation with a global market. These three types of firms are different for training of the entrepreneurs, of the workers. They are different for type of market. Sometimes it's local, sometimes it's the one of the customer, sometimes it's global. We have firms that sometimes have or not a relationship with policies. So as you can see, it's very difficult to say small firm and to address only one condition. Moreover, it's very interesting the debate that we often do. We say small firms are beautiful under the condition that they are a large firm, that they grow, that they change. In Italy, we say beautiful things about people that are small. We say that they are Venus in miniature and so on. I would never say under the condition that you grow. Why we necessarily support small firms under the condition that they are different? So, as you see, the debate is very colorful, it's very differentiated, and our task is going to be big. But we rely a lot on your also support and contribution to our discussion. In this respect, let me start asking Lamia, that is in charge of this matter inside the OECD, to provide us with a fair picture that set the scene. How, Lamia, do you think can the small firms contribute to the SDGs? Should they?
Thank you very much, Mario. You know, the OECD is about numbers first. So I would like to start by, again, recalling some important numbers. When we talk about SMEs, at least in OECD countries, they could represent, on average, 60% of total employment. But this can go up to 80% in countries like Greece, Italy, Korea, and so on. They can represent 50% of business value added. But in emerging market economies in developing countries, SMEs represent up to 90% on average. So given this number, you know, the real question is not so much how SMEs can contribute to the SDGs, but rather how the SDGs could be achieved without the SMEs. So, but let me then open a parenthesis. This morning, the Secretary General, in his opening remarks, he made a speech about the question of backlash against globalization. He was referring to the rise of populism, rise of discontent, rise of mistrust between citizen and government. And of course, this was explained in large part due to the phenomenon of rising inequalities. But the backlash against globalization is not just a phenomenon of people rejecting globalization, but it's also linked to inequalities between firms. Actually, the SMEs, in many countries, they are forming part of what we call the silent majority, which feels unheard by their elite and which feels threatened by, you know, changes in the global market and changes by the technology. There is a feeling that the system in general, even it's a perception, maybe it's true or not true, well, there are some evidence that in some cases it's true, that the system is biased towards large firms, and I'm looking forward to hearing the representative of Tata about that. So there is no doubt, Mario, that reaching the SDG will really require that all individuals are on board, but also all type of firms are on board. So to answer your specific question, how they can, you know, help to achieve the SDGs, to be more concrete, you know, first, they are essential to achieve the SDG number 8, you know, or the important one, inclusive and sustainable economic growth and decent work for all, although the question of job quality is a key issue in many SMEs. They are also major drivers of innovation and industrialization. We know that most of the breakthrough innovation comes from small firms. This has been widely documented, and this is the goal number 9. The SMEs can also contribute to many other goals. I'm thinking about, for instance, the one on reducing inequality, goal number 10. The one on sustainable and inclusive cities, goal number 11. This is the SMEs, and in particular, the role of social enterprises that we tend to put in the category of SMEs, are essential in terms of delivering, you know, public services, health, waste management, but also they have a key role in providing job to those people who are really detached from the labor market. And last but not least, the SDG on gender. You know, I'm just back from Jordan. I was taking part in a conference on socioeconomic empowerment of women, and I had the opportunity to exchange a lot with women. Actually, the entrepreneurship rate of men is 3 times higher than women in the MENA region. This is the largest gap in the world. So like other small entrepreneurs, women face the same obstacles. But in addition to that, there are some very specific obstacles in the region linked to social and cultural norms, linked to the fact that women, in general, they don't have the same access to entrepreneurial network, for instance. So there are many obstacles that could be addressed. And of course, the question of access to finance, we will come back to that. Women face more difficulty to have access to finance. So yes, there are many, many ways where SMEs can provide a valuable contribution to many of these SDGs.
Thank you, Lamia. I retain 3 things in particular from the information you gave us. The first is that SMEs, in many cases, constitute the bone of our economies. They have always been there, they will continue to be there, and there are reasons of efficiency why they are there. But at the same time, here comes an immediate political issue. Some entrepreneurs, maybe a large majority of small and medium-sized entrepreneurs, do not perceive that their voice matters as much as they think should be when it comes to talking to government. The second information that I think is important that you gave us is, in the case of developing country, often one additional factor is there, which is informality. And then the third, the point that you made about gender and how it plays, in the case of Jordan is the one that you represented. I work in 91 in Jamaica on the textile sector, and I remember in that case, a large majority of entrepreneurs were women. It didn't mean that the difficulties they faced were so different. So it's not that much the proportion, but the issue. Let's stay on the point on informality. Informality is often seen as a symptom, but also a cause of weak competitiveness of small firms. Therefore, addressing the issue of informality is particularly crucial. So I would like to call into our discussion Carolina Castro now and ask her how the government can reduce the cost of formalization. There are many costs related to it. First of all, there are bureaucratic costs, there are taxes, there are skills requirements that comes together with formalization. So if your objective is to allow small firms to be better and therefore formalize as well, what the government can do in this respect?
Good morning to all. Thank you very much for the invitation, joining this panel, this session this morning. Argentina has a working population of 21 million people. And of those, 60% have jobs in the formal sector. So we need to create 8 million formal jobs. So the challenge is huge. As in many other Latin American countries, informality is still very high, even though we have transitioned economic growth in certain years of the past decades. Informality is still at large one of our greatest challenges. But we believe that the agenda or the aspects that you posed to me, Mario, in your question, like how do we reduce informality or better the cost of formalization, to put it in another way, how do we access credit, etc., are all part of a wider, broader agenda that we have to push forward. That's called the agenda on productivity. You also mentioned productivity as something very important for SMEs. 70% of jobs in Argentina are created by SMEs, and SMEs are more than 98% of the companies in our country. But they still lack, when you compare them with big companies, a lack of productivity, and an enormous lack of productivity. So we need to work on that agenda. And I would like to emphasize in my response today to that question, five aspects that the Ministry of Production that I represent today here has taken and put in place, regulatory changes and new programs as from December 2015. You know, we have a new government administration for the past 16 months. And so we have really pushed forward this agenda. I will not speak of all of the things we are doing because I will bore you up. But I would like to emphasize four aspects: taxes, financing, digital economy, and entrepreneurs, all linked to the SME policy. As far as taxes, according to the World Economic Forum, Argentina has the highest tax rate over profits in the world. From 2004 to 2015, our country increased fiscal pressure 10 points of our GDP, from 23% to almost 34%. And this tax burden is especially important for SMEs. So one of the first actions we took last year was the promotion of a law that we are very happy passed through Congress, was promulgated through Congress last year. That's an SME law that basically reduces taxes. So today, more than 200,000 SMEs in Argentina are paying less taxes than they used to in the past administration. And this measure, with other measures that were taken, are bringing down fiscal pressure in 1 point of our GDP. Remember, we went up 10 points. We are going through the path of reducing that fiscal pressure, and we are starting up by SMEs that we think are the ones that most need it. But the SME law as well gave an incentive to investments. So now SMEs that invest have a fiscal benefit. They pay even less taxes when they are investing. This is something new. The OECD, in one of its last tax reports, stated that within 38 countries, less than 6 countries didn't have any type of tax preferences for SMEs. Argentina was one of those countries. So this is a very important law for us, putting the agenda on less taxes on SMEs forward. As for financing, another severe problem for SMEs, I guess, worldwide, but especially in developing countries and in Latin America. In Argentina, credit to private sector represents 15% of our GDP. If you compare that number, even in the region, we are far behind. Chile has almost 100%, Brazil 70%, depending on what number you take. But I mean, we are really far behind, and we need that financial system to really reach out for SMEs. So from the Ministry of Production, we promoted new programs, new credit lines for SMEs. Many of them, I will mention just one, that's called My First Credit Line, that was specifically targeted to SMEs that in the past 3 years could not acquire a long-term credit for investment. So when we speak on productivity, we need to understand that means technology. Technology needs investments, and investments need long-term credit. So now there is a line at very good taxes, rates, I'm sorry, for SMEs that was created by the Ministry of Production. But our impact is limited, if you want, of what we can do with the budget of a ministry. So we push forward a regulatory change in a line. It's a credit line that's regulated by the central bank. But basically what it does is compels private and public commercial banks to give as much as 17% of their credit portfolio to SMEs financing. So this meant only last year that $4,000 million were injected to SMEs credit. So really giving an impact there for working capital and for investments. Of course, we understand there are new ways of financing, and we should not only be looking at what traditional banking system can do, but modern financing. So we have passed another law, promulgated another law. This is really recent. It passed through Congress last week, and we are very happy for it. That's an entrepreneur's law. So we had the SME law last year, and this year we have the entrepreneur's law that has two chapters. One of the chapters has to do with financing, and it allows, for instance, crowdfunding platforms to operate. There was no regulatory framework for crowdfunding platforms, now there is. It also gives a fiscal benefit to those that invest in risk capital, and it creates funds of fund to accelerate social-based projects and technologically-based programs. We are expecting this year to have 7 operating funds with 40% public capital in those funds. And then moving on to the digital economy agenda, that I think is also a very important agenda when coming to SMEs, because the world is moving from the third to the fourth industrial revolution, and we still have many, 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 many SMEs that are not up to the state of the art in what has to do with information technology, for instance, in their production and commercial processes. So we need to help them out, because if we do not do anything, I guess only big companies will be able to take this step. And SMEs productivity with the big company will be higher of what we even have today. So in that sense, we will be launching this year, this is a project, a digitalization plan, as many other countries that are moving forward in this agenda, and we have been in contact with them to reach out for best practices. We will start off with a diagnosis of what has been done, and what is the state of the situation. And in the meanwhile, meaning during this year, we will plan the agenda, but we want to redirect some of our programs to help SMEs technically and financially in moving forward with database, financing, and quality management systems in their enterprises, because we think this is a first step to a digital agenda. Last, as for entrepreneurs, that they are part of the SME community, they are future SMEs, if we want to. We have not today good indicators. The Doing Business Index has ranked Argentina last year in 116 from 190 countries. So we have, again, a lot of challenges in that agenda. So as I told you, the entrepreneurs law that we passed last week, one of the main concerns when we arrived was how difficult it was for entrepreneur to formalize a business, to set it up. In Argentina, it can take up to 1 year to do everything that you have to do to formalize your business. So we need to push that agenda moving forward. And with this new law, we expect a business to be created and formalized, including the opening of a bank account, in 24 hours. That is our challenge. That is our commitment with the entrepreneurs world in Argentina. And on the other hand, it has created a new legal entity that we think is much more flexible than what we have, that allows just one partner to be part of the company. It is a legal entity with limited liability, And it also reduces the requirement for minimum share capital to constitute this new society. So this is some of the agenda we are pushing forward. We understand, as the indicators I told you, we are very far away from the world we would like in Argentina, but the path has been taken, and we need to continue in these policies moving forward to a direction that brings about an improvement in productivity.
Thank you, Carolina. So here we have a wide spectrum of action that can be undertaken, and you are undertaking. Let me pick up the first two, because I think they are particularly important. The first, the changes in taxes. Let me just recall one point, which is crucial. We know that the internal mobilization of resources, taxes, is the most important source of financing for government, including when it comes to SDGs. Now, this source is particularly low in many countries. It's not the case with Argentina. If the average revenue out of GDP in OECD countries is 35% of GDP, in many developing countries, unfortunately, including in Latin America, the percentage is between 15 and 20%, which is obviously not capable to provide government with a capacity of fire. It's not the case in Argentina, in Uruguay, in Brazil. What is interesting that maybe here the problem is the composition of the tax revenue. And here your efforts are going in a direction that make the action of the government and fiscal revenue more legitimated in a certain respect. But the second point is everything you said about financing is a traditional point when we discuss of small and medium-sized firms, and you know why. Because small firms, even if it has the same amount of money that a large one, has less reputation, less trust, less element to require the credit, and therefore there is in the market of credit an imperfection that we all know, and therefore it's important to intervene in this field. We heard what Argentina is doing. Let me move to the Islamic Development Bank. Being a bank, obviously, is very much legitimacy in this field. So what, as a bank, you intend to do to foster entrepreneurship in developing countries, but also you are not a bank as the other, you are a crucial bank. And so your voice when it comes to government is particularly important. And so what do you say government they should do in order to support entrepreneurship?
Well, thank you very much, and thanks for the invitation. Mario, before this, I think there is a fundamental difference that we really need to keep in mind. We, as a bank, as you said, the first thing that comes to mind, we dish out money. And honestly speaking, in the past, IDB itself has been financing infrastructure projects. You would agree with me, financing $200 million power station is much easier than financing $10 million SME project. The design, the effort in implementation, in monitoring, it's quite big. So the idea is the shift to the SMEs and to the perhaps the poorer segments of the society and the population is a fundamental mindset that we really need to look at differently as we approach the SMEs. I've heard jobs, SMEs gives you 60% up to 90% depending on the country you're talking about, the jobs are with the SMEs. And I'm glad the SDGs are talking about something called decent jobs. I'm very happy with this qualification. What's decent, what's not? Because creating jobs, with all respect to all governments, sometimes the statistics, it's an aspirin. They need to come up with statistics at the end of the year, and they need to show more jobs have been created. Sometimes it's just isomorphic mimicry, basically. It's just to say, this is what the countries are doing, and this is what we need to report on. But what's decent and what's not a decent job? I mean, low productivity, low paying, non-sustainable jobs in non-productive sectors are not really the decent jobs that we're looking for. But back to what we need to be looking at, actually, the idea is not to create jobs, but really is to pull up a great segment of the population through the SMEs to a better life, to a decent life. And what we see, actually, let me take a minute here. You talked about formality and informality. Just picture with me, we have 7 billion people in the world. About 2 billion are the advantaged, maybe middle income, high income, what have you. But they do have the empowerment to really do business. They have the institutions. They have the legal system. They have the finance. And you have about 4 to 5 billion people who are not necessarily the under a dollar a day or under $1.90 a day, but the low income. You have the single family headed by women. You have the entrepreneurs who cannot find access to finance, or the you have also the highly educated people with no jobs, basically. So you do have about 4 to 5 billion people, and you have 2 billion people on the other side. And look at the market. You have high return opportunity market, which is formal, which is empowered, and you have the 2 billion people have access to all this huge market, and you have that small informal market where these disadvantaged people really continue to thrive on, perhaps sustain themselves, going up and down, but really not making any breakthroughs. So I think the shift here need to be not really just access to finance. I respect what you said about access to finance. It's necessary, but it's not sufficient. If you throw money at poor people, this is not going to solve their problems. And at the end of the day, you might even end up having poor people, indebted poor people. I mean, even it could be worse. So I think the shift should be really towards empowering. A shift should be happening from finance for development to empowerment for development. And finance could come part of this. And you can see that the money that goes into take an example, a microcredit. And this is why I'm telling you, we're trying to change things, at least in our activities in IDB. You can ask a small entrepreneur who needed something. You just give them the money, and hopefully they will give it back. And poor people, usually, they give back the money. But after this, we don't know what happens. I think we really need to look at these poor people as weak people. Back to the entrepreneurship. I think all of us are entrepreneurs. Everybody was born as an entrepreneur. And we don't have poor and non-poor people. I think we have strong, empowered people, and we have weak people. If these poor people, you give them the empowerment tools, they will know how to do business, then they will get out of their poverty. They will deal with their poverty. They will create jobs. We don't have to be enslaved to the notion of creating jobs, because these people will find a way, and they are better entrepreneurs than people sitting in Paris or in Washington or in Jeddah or wherever, because they are on the field. They can come up with their own ways of dealing with their poverty and creation of jobs. And back to the SDGs, how they can help SDGs. If you can do this, see, with the poor people, with the small SMEs, you still have to deal with their health. You still have to deal with the provision of their education. You still have to deal with food security issues. But if you create the entrepreneurship, these people will be able to really deal with their own health issues and education issues, and they will help in achieving the SDGs in a more effective and efficient way. So I think this paradigm shift is enormous. I will not take long, or I'll get back to IDB. IDB, we do 75%, 80% of our work on infrastructure. It's important, but now we're shifting towards giving more attention to the SMEs. But we would like to offer a package. Instead of just giving money, we want to offer a package. Perhaps I could talk about this later. But we're doing things in Sudan, in Afghanistan now, and in Palestine. And the thing that I wanted to say is, you'll be shocked and you'll be surprised that using different modalities than just access to finance, than just giving loans, and I might talk about some of the modes of financing, that we need to participate with these SMEs, put some money, empower them, bring business partners from outside. Like in Sudan, for example, we have potato farmers, for example. If we can hook them up with a state-of-the-art company from Holland, this company will bring the best seeds and will bring the best know-how. And at the same time, they will be the distribution channels for these farmers in Sudan. they had difficulties taking their products down to the capital of Khartoum, let alone taking it and exporting it to the regions, to the neighboring regions. So what I'm saying is we need to really change the way we do things. We started, we have given a lot of lines. By the way, this is the common MDB way to deal with the SMEs. We go to an intermediary in the country, we give them a $50 million, and we give them guidelines how to spend this money, how to give it to the rest. They make a lot of money, we make a little bit of money, but it's just loans, basically. At the end of the day, we give them debt. We did over $650 million over 35 lines in IDB. We do have a private sector arm called ICD, also has given almost $380 million. But again, we're not completely happy and satisfied with what we are doing. We're changing to that mode of empowerment now. We're happy with some of the results we got in Sudan and in Palestine, and now we're trying to replicate that in Tunisia, in Afghanistan, Benin, and Guinea very soon. Thank you.
Very interesting. It would be interesting also to discuss with you how this is done. That there is a change, a paradigm shift, is clear from your words. How do you connect? Traditionally, it's the intermediary. But now, what? We will come back to this point. Let me just move to the Tata, to the large firm. We have heard from Carolina that there are different areas in which we have to intervene, one of which is taxes, one of which is finance. But we also heard from Carolina that one thing that is crucial is the dissemination of innovation, is improving the quality and the control of quality of products, is a series of other things that has to deal with the production itself. Now, when you are a large firm and you use subcontractor, you are on the side in which you issue rules, regulation, requirements for concerts, and so on. Can you tell us about, David, the relationship between, therefore, being a large firm, originally from a developing country, now a global value chain, obviously, and small firms, subcontractors in developing countries? How it comes, what are the needs you have?
Aria, thank you very much. Let me just say a word or two about Tata first. Yeah, certainly a large firm. I'll use 100, number 100 three times. We're a $100 billion business. We're in 100 or so different countries around the world, and we've got 100 or so different businesses within our group. In India, the press says we're the salt-to-steel conglomerate. Personally, I prefer tea to IT. But beyond that, we've also got businesses in, for example, financial services, infrastructure, and retail. We're the largest business group in India, and I'm going to focus a little bit on India in what I say. And we were founded in 1868 by a man, Jamshedji Tata, who said, and it sounds very 21st century what he said, but he said it, I'm told, he said, in a free market economy, society is not just another stakeholder, it's the very purpose of business. And we try to have that in mind. I'm not saying we're perfect, but we try to have that in mind. And that is an aim and an aspiration. And two-thirds of our holding company's equity is still held by the charitable trust set up by previous generations of the Tata family. So I'm going to focus primarily on India. And so, because we're at the OECD, I will also throw in a couple of numbers. The SME sector makes up something like 38% of India's GDP. It's the second largest employer after agriculture, which of course itself is very much a small business sector on the whole. And slightly worryingly, it creates 70% of the environmental pollution in India. So there are really good reasons for a focus on the SME sector. But why in a sense, have you invited me here? Why are we here? Can large business be part of the solution, or is it just part of the problem? And that's actually a question. I mean, I work for the Tata Group in Europe. I focus primarily on, as it were, developed world problems rather than developing world problems. And exactly the same question is asked. Are large businesses part of the problem or the solution? I think they very much can be part of the solution because we are part of the same value chains, and we do actually depend very much on each other. We're competing far less than we are collaborating. And certainly for us, and certainly with our particular critical mass and weight in India and a focus, the SDGs are very important to the way we are looking at our role in society today and developing our programmes. And the relevance of SMEs to that is absolutely clear to us. Now, what is that relationship? How does that work for large companies? I think, you know, a large part of what we need to do can actually come from the self-interest of large companies, because you need your the SMEs both in your supply chain, so you want them to be producing what you want, good quality, innovative products. But also, if you take, for example, our beverages business, and we have other food businesses too, you need them as your distributors. In a large country with large rural populations, you are very often relying on small businesses to distribute your products. So we absolutely need them. But I think it goes beyond that, because the small businesses, just take those figures again, the 38% of GDP, the second largest employer, that means those small businesses are part of the society in which the large businesses are functioning. So we need them, and there is a great deal, I think, that that large business can do for them. Let me just give you a few examples. We've talked a bit about access to finance, and as we've said, necessary but not sufficient, but certainly necessary. And we have a financial services business, Tata Capital, which works with the Confederation of Indian Industry to help provide finance for small businesses, but also the financial support and advice and infrastructure that the smaller business members of the CII need. There's a part of Tata Capital called Tata Clean Tech, which is looking specifically at financing environmental sustainability projects with small businesses. So again, these help make your supply chain more efficient, producing better quality products, but also reducing their environmental footprint. So that's one example. Tata Motors, I mean, I should have mentioned the kind of elephant in the room. I didn't mention among our businesses, of course, is cars and commercial vehicles, is motors. And there we have a very large supply chain, often of SMEs. And many of those will have grown up around our large manufacturing plants and are exclusively or largely servicing our businesses. And there we have a strong incentive, and I think this can be absolutely symbiotic, to help develop the efficiency, the production processes, the quality processes of those businesses, and we have programs looking at that, but also, again, the environmental sustainability. If you're manufacturing on a small scale in a developing country, environment parts for an automotive business, there is undoubtedly a large margin by which you can reduce your environmental footprint with the right investments, with the right know-how, with the right technologies. And indeed, actually, there, I think I've said it, apart from finance, what is it that you need? It's essentially skills, know-how, and technologies. And that operates, you know, we see this from the breadth of the businesses that we're in. We see a huge range of opportunities. We have a jewellery making business, for example, Titan, which has set up facilities for small artisan jewellers to operate, to learn and improve, and there are centres for them where they can go and work. But of course, if you're operating in rural India, it's no good just setting up a centre and sending people home at the end of the day. There's nowhere to go. So the accommodation and the rest of the infrastructure, recreational activities and so on, have to be provided as well. So you've got to look at the environment you're operating in and what actually makes something work, just like saying that finance is necessary but not sufficient. So the intervention which might make sense in a large city or in a developed economy is not going to make sense unless you bring the rest of the infrastructure with it. Again, it's very much dependent on the specific environment you're in. I think general rules in this are quite difficult. In India, there are a number of communities which have traditionally been seriously disadvantaged, and the affirmative action program is still very relevant there, providing opportunities often for people who would otherwise not have those opportunities, and who then can operate down the value chain, as it were, as vendors or as entrepreneurs who in some way are using the products which the Tata company, the larger companies, are making. So I think there's a range of interventions across the value chain. They've got to be targeted very much to the specific environment you're operating in, urban, rural, the particular sector that you're operating in. But there's a big scope, I think, for large business to get quite a long way down this road, simply through those, if you like, kind of self-interested interventions which will improve the value chain. But you can then go considerably further towards looking at the sustainability, both of the communities and the environment.
Thank you, David. We had a first round our participant in the panel. This point, I think, is particularly important because it tells us how different model of or industrial organization help more or less small firms to grow. Let me take a sector different from the one that we have mentioned. If you take knitting, you have different models of organizing the production. In France, I imagine many of you knows a little crocodile that appears in T-shirts. This is produced by a firm that is called De Van Lee, which is in Troyes, and is vertically integrated, the firms. It doesn't use that much subcontractor, as the comparative advantage is the color of the T-shirt. But then you have another firm that maybe you have heard, and it's called Benetton, and mainly is done by one mother firms and 385 subcontractors that work only for Benetton. When it comes to the subcontracting relationship, the fact that they are in exclusive relationship with the mother firms create a different type of relations. In reality, innovation very often needs to come from the mother firms, either about how to dye a shirt or how to strengthen the fibers. Completely different is the situation in which you have small subcontractors that are intelligent. Some years ago, between the First and the Second Punic War, I used to teach in a university. And at that time, I had two brilliant students that went to see how I was working the buying department of Renault. They were so brilliant that they have studied very in detail the books, and they were expecting to find in the buying offices of a large firms only sellers, psychologists capable to make good deal. And they were surprised because in these buying offices, there were engineers. What have happened? That the subcontractor had become intelligent. And if you want to create a good relationship, you need to know the product. You need to know what you are asking for. And obviously, this intelligence came from the fact that now you have subcontractors working for many firms, adjusting the machine, adjusting the product, and this creates the intelligence and the learning. So very interesting subject we have heard. Let's come back very quickly and then open the floor. So I will ask you to be this time a little bit shorter in your answer. And let's start with Lamia. Lamia, we have heard from Carolina several different types of tools that can be used by a government. You work not only with one government, you work with many governments in OECD and non-OECD countries. Do you have anything to add about the range of policy that can be used or the priorities in these policies?
Thank you, Mario. Actually, it's true that the Undersecretary provided already a very comprehensive overview of the type of policy to be put in place. These are really related to the regulatory and institutional framework that should be conducive to all type of firms at all stage of the business cycle. By the way, we're going to launch a report about that, looking at all type of issues, taxes, finance, technology, and so on. And yesterday, we decided that the title will be Small, Medium, Strong. Because the idea that we want to push forward is that small can be beautiful, actually, if we have the right condition in place. So having the right business environment is one thing, but it also makes sense to have some targeted SMEs policies. And this really depends on the local context and the right condition. When we talk about access to finance, for instance, I was not just talking about providing finance to the poor or the very, you know, the informal sector. It's not just about that. During the global crisis, actually, in advanced economies, those small and medium-sized firms that were really very, you know, engaged in the market and so on, they faced terrible conditions to get access to credit. So it's much broader than that. So, but you're completely right. We need to empower the entrepreneurs, not just by providing finance, but with additional means. Another point that I wanted to make, Mario, is related to something that the Undersecretary mentioned, the question of productivity. It figures at the top of your policy agenda in your country. Actually, last year, it was the year of the productivity. I mean, in the last ministerial meeting, we launched a report called the Productivity Inclusiveness Nexus. And precisely the point that we made there is that we find a correlation between the trend of rising income inequalities and wage dispersion, which was linked to the dispersion in terms of productivity between firms, between small and large firms. And this gap in terms of productivity has really increased. So it's a very important agenda. The key question is, and again, it's linked to the question of backlash against globalization, is that small and medium-sized firms do not really take advantage of being included in the global value chains. When we take, for instance, some of the figures relating to their capacity to export, they represent only 15%. Of course, if we take the indirect contribution, it's a little bit more. But they really face obstacles to access to the GVCs. There are many reasons behind that. You know, the fact that they face higher trade barriers, compliance to international norms, weak managerial skills, et cetera, et cetera. So this is an issue that it's very important. Another point that I would like to make...
Can I stop you there? In fact, when you look at Latin America, for example, you have the fact that the interchanges between firms in Latin America are very limited. Very often we say a perspective now that the level of growth in OECD countries is relatively weak, now that China is engaged in a new normal and therefore the rate of growth went down from 10 to 6, now that Africa is growing at 3.5 instead of the very high level of growth in the past, probably a developing country can try to address more the regional demand and more integrated market can work better. However, when we do this discussion, very often we think to trade tariff barriers. And in reality, when we observe, for example, the transport cost, they represent 8 times the weight that tariff barriers have in the price of a product. So there are other aspects that would strengthen the capacity of small firms to be more productive, more competitive, and so on. And I would like to go, with your permission, to Carolina and ask, therefore, what can we do to help small firms to export, to reach the regional market? Why not also the global? But let's start with the regional market to have, in other terms, more customers, a wider integrated regional economy. Any suggestion on that?
First, an introduction and moving on from what you have just said, as far as us of the regional market, Argentina has not diversified its external markets. 80% of our exports depend on Brazil. So we have one main commercial partner. And Brazil is not having currently a good economic situation. The perspective for next year is not so good. For this year and next year is not so good. Less than 1% growth in terms of GDP. Argentina will be this year 3%, but we will be growing a bit more than the rest of the region, right? And the world is not growing too much either, except for Asia, certain parts of Asia, and the leadership of China. So the international situation is quite complex. Yet, I take along what you said, Mario, in terms that we really have to work the agenda inside of our country, of each country, because competitiveness begins there. Definitely, you mentioned transport cost. And one of my speaking points today was going to be on the infrastructure plan and how this is linked to a better competitiveness and eventually the possibility of our SMEs to be part of regional chains or global value chains. Argentina has launched with this new administration one of the most ambitious infrastructure plan in decades. Just for what has to do with transport, railways, ports, routes, etc. We are expecting the next 4 years to have investments of $35,000 million. And we expect those investments to come from national enterprises, but international enterprises as well, private and public sectors. And we want, because we think this infrastructure plan could be a very good driver for our economy, for SMEs to be part of the infrastructure plan, because then we give them a chance of integrating these chains and eventually with this aggregated demand, be better prepared for a regional or international market. But we understand we cannot leave them alone and just expect this to happen. So we are working on two aspects linked to the infrastructure plan that has to do with SMEs. One is public procurement. So we are passing a new procurement law. Public procurement is 5% of our GDP, and we expect the new infrastructure plan to increase that by 2 points. So it really is a driver for our aggregated demand. And this procurement plan, what we'll have is an SME preference, and it also regulates joint ventures that will be coming to the country for investing in this infrastructure plan and the technology transfers that we expect those investments make with our SMEs as local partners. So we are working on that agenda, and as well, we have launched a program that we call Suppliers Development Program, and we are targeted to certain key areas of the infrastructure plan, like railway, energy, health, and others. So this program, what it does is it gives technical and financial assistance to SMEs that are part of these chains, expecting for them to be of better quality and of better productivity for when this investment comes, they will be able to be part of the procurement plan, being of public expenditure or private investment.
Stop here, because you made a point about infrastructure. Let me move to the Islamic Development Bank, Rami Ahmad, and ask him something. Again, between the two Punic War, when I was at university, I went around in the countryside in Italy, which is my country, asking small firms what they needed, what they can do, and so on. And for many years in Italy, we have given a lot of money to the south of the country, in particular the small firms, in order to modernize them. They were more similar to the Macondo type that I made this morning. In reality, this money didn't help that much. So in one hand, when you speak with the small firms and you say, what do you need? They say money and more market, which is like when you go to see a doctor and the doctor asks you, what do you need to be better? But how to be better is the issue. And just giving money, very often the small entrepreneurs buys the same machine that he or she already has in the factory. And there is not innovation, there is just extension. And why? Because there are no information about the new technology, about the new machine, about the new product, and the new market trends. You said this point, because you said, maybe we need infrastructure to connect the firms to the market, but then they have to have good product to present. Just giving money is not enough. You made this very interesting example about Sudan and potatoes. So how do you do it? How do you bring the firms to know where to go
to spend that money.
Thanks. If I knew the question, there would be no poverty in the world today, I guess. This is the most complicated question, actually, to empower the SMEs and the less advantaged, really, to get into what you just said. And just right off the bat, a lady in Senegal that needs, for example, a sewing machine. Yes, she wants a sewing machine. You're a microfinance, perhaps, or a financial institution. You go and ask for an invoice. And the lady comes back with an invoice for $450. You write a check for $450. She gets the sewing machine, and good luck. Hopefully, she will pay back. But if you think about how we can do it differently, because they don't have the information, if we have NGOs or development institutions in the field who can identify, and probably there are, and this happened, by the way, 100 ladies that need a sewing machine. And this institution would go and buy wholesale, and the sewing machine will end up costing $150. If this financial institution have a creative, innovative way of financing, they will come and add a tab on this, for example, and sell it for $200 to the lady on installments for 6 months. She owned the machine. In the previous scenario, she owned the machine too, but she paid a lot for it. And the financial institution probably charged 2-3% a month or something like this, adding up to 36%. So they might have sustained themselves, these ladies, getting by $450. But you see the tremendous difference in the income generating capacity of I think the key word here, how can we help these people not necessarily be a small business? I understand you said when you want you to grow bigger, and but the idea is how can we help them develop the capacity to generate income rather than just to pay us back? And here a few things. Another example in the West Bank in Palestine. We, with the help of the UNDP, by the way, we went to 13,000 families. Each family has turned into a small business now because of providing them, studying their situation, providing them with a business opportunity, with some studies, because they didn't know all this information. So if we, as MDBs and other institutions, can train NGOs in the field to go and help them by providing them business models, by providing them feasibility studies, by identifying strategic partners. I talked about the potato in Sudan, for example. In Tunisia, perhaps in a dairy milk factory, we can hook them up with Danone, for example. And this is happening, by the way. Solidarity financing, the example I just gave. Other institutions can also help the farmers. Instead of giving money, we'll provide the infrastructure for water, for example, for a percentage of the harvest later. They don't have to pay even money. We'll provide you the water, and you will agree to give 30%. We will take the whole harvest from you. Using equipment in agriculture, a farmer who has 1 or 2 hectares cannot really buy a harvester, world-class harvester. But an institution, a development institution, can buy that harvester and rent it on a daily basis to 100 or 200 farmers. These innovative ways of getting ourselves as MDBs, as development institutions, is crucial. Otherwise, we will take the easy route by just giving the money to some intermediary and this is a lot of hard work. But this needs a lot of change in the efficiency and effectiveness of the money. And by the way, the money will come. I'm glad I heard something about crowdfunding. I think governments really need to institute some policies for crowdfunding. Many countries, at least the countries that I'm working in, many people would like to put charity, but they don't know where the charity is going. They would like it to go for economic empowerment. If the governments could put in place regulations for crowdfunding with robust payment systems to make sure that this is, I think and this morning we heard about the money is there if we know what we're doing. So the idea is it's the challenge to our innovative thinking in really getting things done.
Thank you, Rami. It's very interesting, very important. I will tell you in
sometime later, and a direct experience I had in Italy in this field when I was in charge of regional industrial policy in a region, and it's very similar to what you are saying, very important. But before we open the floor, just one word. David is a secret that we have here with us, because David has been working in the government, in the diplomacy, and now he's working in a large firm. So he's the one which is capable to reveal to us the secret of the communication between firms and government. David, with this unique experience, what would you suggest government to do, therefore, to support SMEs? If possible, in three words.
Well, I was just thinking of what Rami was saying. If I knew the secret, I probably would be somewhere else doing something else with it. But I think the answer is probably with care is the way that business needs to engage with government. Actions speak louder than words, by which I mean, governments can't solve all our problems. Business has a unique ability to deliver and to organise in areas which governments just don't aspire to do and just can't do. Let me give you one example very briefly, and coming back to what Carolina was talking about, informality. You will be aware of the great demonetization initiative in India towards the end of last year, a very bold initiative, quite controversial, to take a lot of currency out of circulation, to take a lot of the black currency out of circulation, to deal with corruption. Very bold, very controversial, early days, long-term implications still not entirely clear. Initially, clearly very disruptive on the economy, including particularly on SMEs, those in the informal sector relying on cash. To make a success, if we don't make a success of this, this will simply weaken the SME sector. To make a success of it, it's a real opportunity to bring the SMEs into the formal sector and to bring all the infrastructure, all the ecosystem around them into that sector. What do you need for that? Well, there's an SDG term for it, I think 21st century infrastructure. The digital payment system in India, which is growing rapidly, but here is a real opportunity. And to make that work, there is a real opportunity for the large corporates, indeed for digital entrepreneurs, a different kind perhaps of SME, to work together to deliver what could be a real step change, both from an economic development and pure kind of GDP point of view, but also for an inclusive growth point of view. So I think the answer is what business can bring is real expertise and action rather than just the lobbying, as it were.
Thank you, David. Let's open now the floor. I know that there are many questions already. Here I have one in front. Do we have a microphone? Can you simply please introduce yourself, but I will be very strong. Only questions, no declaration, please. Okay.
Bonjour. Merci pour vos présentations. Moi, c'est M. Samaseko Ali de l'Université de Bamako, l'Université des sciences sociales et des gestions de Bamako. Je suis microéconomiste, en fait. Donc, j'aimerais intervenir sur le financement des entreprises en Argentine. Comment vous êtes arrivé, par exemple, à mettre en connexion les entreprises, les PME, avec le système bancaire argentin? Quelles ont été les sources de financement? Et je m'adresse aussi à M. Rami Ahmad pour dire que j'ai trouvé dans son intervention quelque chose de très approximatif. Parce que le financement manque chez nous. Moi, je suis malien, je sais que le financement manque beaucoup chez nous. Et je ne sais pas le niveau du financement privé de la Banque islamique de développement. Tous les financements que j'ai vus s'adressaient au gouvernement. Alors, nous avons un système bancaire qui est basé sur l'existence d'un patrimoine, en fait. Au niveau des banques, il faut avoir une garantie pour être financé. Si tu n'as pas de garantie, tu n'as aucun financement. Au niveau des microfinances, ce sont des taux très élevés, de 25%, de 27%, qui ne permet pas à un acteur de rentabiliser. Ce n'est même pas possible. C'est pour vraiment vivre sa vie en payant des crédits et des crédits. Donc, les financements manquent beaucoup. Je ne sais pas à quel niveau, souvent, vous avez pu arriver à financer les privés, mais au Mali, moi, je crois que la Banque islamique, en matière de financement privé, est absente. Enfin, merci.
D'accord, merci. Let's take three, and then we do a second turn.
Madame.
Thank you very much. Just one proposal, not a question, a proposal that addresses as much Mr. Ahmad or Mr. Landsman. It is the potential contribution of remittances by diasporas. This is a way to finance for the sewing machine. This is a way, I mean, remittances by Indians, the amount, official remittances by Indians, the amount something like $275 billion last year. And that's only the emerged part of the iceberg. This is, these are World Bank statistics. I guess for your countries, this is something to be taken into consideration. Thank you.
Yes, this is crucial. The most important source of financing in developing countries, taxes, is followed by foreign direct investment and remittances more or less on the same level. Unfortunately, little work is done on remittances. In the OECD Development Center, together with the World Bank in the NOMAD initiative, we are trying to catch up with this information. The real policy issue here is how to mobilize the remittances and the diaspora for public goods or small and medium-sized firms. Here there are some examples in Mexico, like Tres por Uno, $1 of remittances to from the government, but that's the issue, how to mobilize these resources that in privilege goes towards private consumption. A third question, and then there, and then we have a second round.
Thank you. My name is Aldo Parodi, Trade Commissioner of Peru in France. My question is to Carolina. Our countries face similar problems. And I am very interested in how the private bank reacted when the central bank compelled them to have a percentage of their portfolio to be aimed to the SMEs. Thank you.
Thank you. Very precise question. Why don't we start with the Islamic Development Bank, and then we go to Carolina, and then we take a second round, at least.
Okay, I agree with you. Sorry, I didn't pick your name in the beginning. But this is exactly why we are calling for a paradigm shift. The idea is really the funding is needed. We cannot live without the funding. It's how we are deploying the funding. If we are charging the beneficiary 36% a year, and like you said, and rightly said, if I got the translation correct, this is very frustrating. What we are calling for, and what we tried in Sudan, by the way, you mentioned Sudan, we put $17 million and we asked the government to match it. So they put $17 million. And we put it in a certain way that we will use different ways of financing. The money will still go for the users. For example, the farmers would not need to take the cash per cash, but they need a storage facility, for example. We will build the storage facility and we will give them for a percentage of their harvest, the services of a storage facility. Or providing the water. We will build the infrastructure to get the water from the river to their lands. And they will put, so they are empowered with the means, without even an exchange of cash, for a shareholding. We are empowering these farmers to become shareholders. By time, if, machines, for example, maybe you will have more to say about this, but with 5 years, instead of renting them the machine, year after year, they will become the owners of this machine. So we need to think differently. And what you said about the IDB is true. Largely, we have been financing governments to do infrastructure, to do health facilities. And now the shift is going to be on more the private sector. And we heard this morning, without the private sector, basically, if all the ODAs, despite your Secretary General this morning, he said it's slightly up. Depending on who you talk to achieve the SDGs, we're talking about $3 to $4 trillion every year. And all the ODAs are less than $140 billion. So, but point taken, it's a new ways of channeling what's needed. The money was still needed, but it's how we use it, how we are using it. Really, with
so here we have two issues. No? One is the volume of credit, and the other is how do you use it the best. Sometimes the volume of credit is not enough. But even when you have credit, the issue is how do you have institutions, public or private, that are between the government and the citizen, that are capable to provide a series of real services that the entrepreneurs don't find on the market. I give you another example. In a province in Italy, it's called Modena, which is a province dominated by small firms and where it's produced things of a certain value, Lamborghini, Maserati, Ferrari, and so on. In this place, There is a business association that organized 16,000 entrepreneurs with less than 10 employees. And they work in mechanic and so on. Now, this association, there are three of this type, has 500 employees. In a province of 250,000 people, 500 employees. What do they do? Every year, every month, they prepare 14,000 pay pockets. They do the input, the declaration of taxes for 25,000 firms, and so on. Is it the role of an entrepreneurial association? Why not? But traditionally, we think to them as lobbyists. In this case, they provide services. Why? Because the market, for different reasons that we can discuss, is not capable to provide. I think that what the Islamic Development Bank is saying to us is that role is desperately needed in many cases. It's not necessarily a bank, it can be other actors to cover it, but the role is crucial. Carolina.
As for the first question, we have the same problem. I mean, I'm going to be honest. Guarantees are a problem in many of the developing countries, and it is very hard for traditional banking to not look at guarantees and start looking at the cash flow, at the possibility of the business, the perspective of what that business can bring about. So what we are doing is we have a system of, we call, I don't know if the translation is correct, of mutual guarantees. It's like a society that, that specializes in giving guarantees to SMEs outside of what central bank regulations would ask for. And they enter, and they have a commission, of course, and they give the guarantee. The system works, but it has limited impact. Our government, one of the challenges we have is making that guarantee, mutual guarantee system have more impact, so make it bigger. Like, for example, they have in Chile. Chile is a very good example. I don't know if there's someone from Chile today here, but they have really a good guarantee system. So that goes for guarantees. We have a bank now. The Ministry of Production is the main shareholder in a public bank that's called the Bank of Investments and Foreign Trade that is specializing in SMEs. And even though the bank is being regulated by the central bank, as any other bank, it has certain flexibility, because it is a public bank, to take certain risks like outside central bank norm. So we are very much using that to help SMEs get their loans. On the other side, we have the grants, okay, for the entrepreneurs that there we don't ask for any guarantee, and it's a grant scheme, as Mr. Ahmad just told us. But again, the impact is limited. This is why we think one of our main, my first interventions, I spoke about taxes, and I told you about the fiscal pressure that we have. That's different from any other Latin American country. And the second point I wanted to face was finance, because I think there is our biggest challenge. But again, I don't want to forget what Mario said. It is true, you give the money, then for what and how? So technical assistance has to be part of how we get the money to SMEs. So many times we see, I go through the whole country. Our country is very big. So once every week, I have to go somewhere. So I move along, and I visit a lot of SMEs to speak to them. And once you realize sometimes that you are facing an SME that wants to ask for a loan to buy a new machine, and I come from the industrial world, so I know industrial processes. And when I see machines, I very rapidly understand that there are two machines that are working at 40% its capacity because proper maintenance has not been done. So what this SME really needs, not to buy another machine, it's to make those machines work 100% capacity. So I think technical assistance is another big question. As for my Peruvian colleague, I'm going to answer in English so everyone understands. But okay, private banking with this regulatory framework of central bank, in the first moment, they were they were not so happy because of this of this compelling for financing. But in the end, what ended happening is that these banks have now new clients, and new clients that gave them their payroll, then have now a credit card, a corporate credit card. So they are getting business around the fact that they are forced to give loans to these SMEs. So in a way, I think now if you ask me honestly, they would prefer not to have this obligation. But in the current situation, they say it's okay because we are getting new businesses.
I have one question here, and then unfortunately we are running out of time.
Thank you. My name is Susan Yukas. I have a question about the very interesting remark on the new procurement law in Argentina, which you mentioned. How do you make such a wonderful sounding provision practical? How do you make it feasible? What have you done? How do you propose to monitor its implementation, particularly but not only in the infrastructure sector? Are there good examples of an effective law of that kind, effective provisions of that kind, in other countries that you know of?
So Argentina is very fashionable today. Let's take another question.
Hello, I'm Sorana Baciu from Romania. I used to be a Secretary of State last year, and one of my tasks was exactly to support the development of SMEs. I really like the shift in paradigm that you mentioned. Indeed, it's about capacity building, empowerment. And now my question is, how SMEs could be empowered by becoming an active actor in achieving sustainable development goals? How can be really involved in developing their communities and taking responsibility for developing communities is a way of growing and being empowered rather than being empowered by others, taking the lead in empowerment.
Let's
Thank
take
you.
These two. Yeah, please go.
Yes, the question about how SMEs can contribute to their communities, actually it's an area of work at the OECD that where we pay a lot of attention. We have a lot of work. The center that I'm heading actually is also covering local economic development, territorial development issues and stuff like that. And actually there is a direct correlation between these issues and SMEs and entrepreneurship. We know that in general, it's very generic, this statement, that large firms tend to speak with national governments, while local leaders, local practitioners, they speak with SMEs. I mean, this notion of the local ecosystem is very important, and the interaction between the local stakeholders is very important. So yes, they do contribute to communities development, and because of this very strong interaction, there is a capacity, to put in place the right mechanism so that we can have a local, vibrant local ecosystem that responds to different objectives, economic and societal, of course.
What's Carolina then, Ahmed?
As for the new procurement law, we do have a public procurement law now, but as you said, the mechanisms of enforcement do not work correctly, and we saw that it had several flaws. So what we promoted as a new administration was a new law. This law has not been passed yet. So it's a project that comes from the Ministry of Production. And basically, we understand it will be passed. And when we have the regulatory decret, decreed. So when everything is in place, what we're expecting this law to ensure is, first of all, a preference on SMEs for public expenditure of about 15%. We want a transparent procedure of forecasts. We believe one of the most difficult things for SMEs when they want to be part of public expenditure is maybe you have the Ministry of Health that decides, wants to do a big public purchase, and so they want, I'm going to say anything, no? 200 x-rays, whatever, like in 2 months. SMEs cannot cope with that time frame, that volume. So you need to make a forecast, and you need to be able to tell SMEs, we will be buying next semester or next year this amount in this time lapses. So SMEs can prepare for that and quote accordingly. This is something we think is very important. On the other hand, we need mechanisms of enforcement, because each one of the ministers has its own expenditure. They decide where they put the money. So as a Ministry of Production, and we are very interested in that Argentina has local production, it has a very strong industrial production, so we want things to be bought in Argentina. So we are going to be having like inter-ministerial coordination, and we will be able to have enforcement over other ministries to assure that they are complying with the new law. I don't want to...
Thank you. Rami.
Well, very quickly on the concept of empowerment, I think there is an associated paradigm shift that comes with the shift from financing to empowerment. It's also how we view the poor or how we view the small businesses, from entities that need to be given something to a partnership relationship. Many of these institutions, the small institutions, if they are treated as business partners, you will see different productivity levels. Example, there's no time for this, but there's a quick example you would see that they own the enterprise, and you are not giving them funding. You are saying they will help the communities. Each one of these small businesses, for example, the one I gave in the West Bank, each one of these 13,000 families has employed between 5 and 126 employees. So you can see what they have done to the community that they are living in. It's because of their success, they are creating jobs around them. Because of their success, another example, a village with Bilal in Sudan, for example. Because of the success of this small community, they are building their health facilities. They are setting aside amounts of money because of the small business. They were not used to making money, basically. They were used to getting handouts. Now they are buying the lands surrounding their villages. So I think the sense of empowerment will go far, far away. And final thing I wanted to say, we do have in IDB 17 modes of financing, starting with the grant and loan, ending up with outright equity, which is risky, I understand. But surprisingly, Mario, surprisingly, we found out that the return on our investments in the other modes of financing, other than the loans and the leasing, is much higher than the straight-out loans that we give to the SMEs. And this is also another paradigm shift, is doing business by way of participation. It has its own risk, for example, but in the grand scheme of things, the return has proved, at least in the experiences that we had, has been even larger than the set-aside percentage that we give on a loan. Thank you.
David, do you want to add anything to these answers?
No, I mean I'm not an expert, and I believe I'm sure it's right that one wants to move to participation rather than to the giving handouts, as it were. But on the other hand, it seems to me that there is plenty of scope when you have, certainly in a large and dispersed country such as India, you have SMEs working with and as agents of, or whatever it might be, large companies. There is scope there for developing a symbiotic relationship. In time, that may lead to something more independent. But I would have thought, from the experience that we have, one shouldn't. It's not that one is good and the other is bad, but there is scope for both.
Thank you. We have spent this time together. I think it was particularly dense. The objective we had was to arrive at 12:30, raising appetite for food that is waiting for us, but also for thought, which means that we are now at the end. But you can grasp one of these people all along the day and ask questions if you liked what was discussed. If you didn't like what was discussed, you can send one of your enemies to grab them and ask questions. But I think we have other ways to continue the discussion, and therefore I want to thank the panelists, and you for being with us, and thank you.
Thank you, Mario. Thank you, everyone, for a very stimulating discussion. As Mario reminded us, it's time for food, and we will go up the escalator and then right to the castle, the chateau. And if you have difficulties finding your ways, just follow our colleagues that you can recognize with their little OECD badge. Bon appétit à tous.